Hillel Goldstein. I'm a pediatric nurse at College Children's. I specialize now in hematology oncology. Don't worry, nothing to do with today's talk. I also am a CPR instructor. I teach here at SBH often, so nice to see a lot of familiar faces. Today's talk is going to be on proper growth and development, and you guys saw my little video. You know, what's normal, what's not, everything in between. There's a nice range of normal behaviors for children. Here, if anybody is asking, it will be taped and put on SBH's website by tomorrow, sbhonline.org. More housekeeping from Nancy. If anyone is on the mailing list, if you are not, get on it. You get more notifications about other talks and events, just like this. In your packets, you guys have copies of the PowerPoints that are going to be presented. Some of them have little lines for notes. Any questions you have, we're going to save for a Q&A at the end. If it helps you, put your question on the paper next to the slide so you can quickly refer back to it and not forget your question. All right, I'm going to introduce our panel of doctors we have here today. Dr. Jason Klein is the director of clinical for the director of the clinic for Pediatric Bone Health Clinic and assistant clinical professor in pediatric endocrinology at the Hassenfeld Children's Hospital, NYU Langone Health. Director of the Pediatric Diabetes Center at NYU Langone Hospital, Brooklyn, and Assistant Clinical Professor in the Department of Pediatrics at NYU Langone, specializing in pediatric endocrinology. Dr. Melanie Greifer is a Clinical Associate Professor and Attending Physician in the Department of Pediatrics at NYU Langone Health, specializing in pediatric gastroenterology. So without further ado, I'm gonna give the mic over to Dr. Klein. You're gonna head first.
Morning, everybody. How you guys doing? I'm gonna grab the clicker. All right. So, Dr. Greifer and myself probably have a lot of overlapping stuff. So we'll try to get through all these slides. And again, if you have any questions, please write them down. We'll be happy to answer all of them towards the end. So what I'm going to be talking a little bit about is kind of an endocrinologist perspective on growth and development, really short stature in particular, and we'll talk about kind of how we as endocrinologists assess and think about, and how you guys as parents also can think about, you know, whether or not there should be any concern or not. So short stature probably tends to be the biggest cause of self-referral to an endocrinologist's office, at least that I see, and it usually comes hand in hand because of this. It's because somebody, either the kid themselves or the parents of the child, see that their child compared to their peers is not as tall as the rest of them, right? And that can often play an effect in terms of how the child feels about themselves, how maybe is projected upon the kid about how they might should feel about themselves, and whether or not they're participating in activities or things like that. From a personal perspective, there's a similar child to both of these pictures, this guy here. So this is my oldest, this is Jacob. And here he is with it. He's in third grade, he's 8 years old. And this is his friend who's also 8 years old in third grade, right? So you can tell there's some high discrepancy here. And here he is with his sister, who is 3 years his younger and in kindergarten. They're pretty similar to the same heights, right? So he's a happy dude. This doesn't really bother him all that much, but sometimes it does bother him, right? And he asks why people treat him like a little kid or why people treat him like he's not as old as he is. So when we think about what the most important thing is from an endocrine perspective about growth, short stature, things like that, how do we assess whether or not there is a problem or why somebody needs to be referred to the endocrinologist? It comes down to really one primary and very, very simple thing that happens at the doctor's office, and that is measuring the child correctly, okay? A lot of times what I'll see is kids who get referred, and that's just because they're not being measured so well at the doctor's office. So sometimes doctor's offices are busy, chaotic, and trying to move patients through very quickly. But if you have any concern at all about your child and their growth, it behooves you to really make sure that they're being measured well and correctly and being plotted on the curve correctly. So babies should be measured really, you know, the best of worlds, not by laying down on the paper and being mucked by the toes and mucked by the head and then measuring with the piece of paper with the tape measure, because babies wriggle and they move around a lot. It's not the most scientific thing and can lead us down pathways that might not be the best. Children should be measured standing on one of these stadiometers. Head gets tilted down a little bit, the apex of the head's towards the top. A lot of kids, when they're measuring, are looking up at the doctor like this, right? So they get shortchanged in some height by doing that. And plotting on the correct curve. So we use these types of curves, which I'm sure you guys have seen before. The blue is for boys, the pink is for girls. And we use the WHO chart for the little kids up to age 2, in the CDC charts for older kids. And these are standardized kind of plots that we use to plot heights on. There are special curves for children who have different disorders like Down syndrome or Turner syndrome or other genetic syndromes. So if you plot somebody who has one of those syndromes on one of these curves, they will likely look much shorter, and people might think that there's a problem or a reason for concern. You're just using the improper chart. So it all starts with your data that you're getting at the office. This is an example of just a regular growth curve with the percentiles marked. There's a wide range of normal between the 3rd percentile and the 97th percentile. Really is all like quite a range of normal. And a lot of this depends on the genetics of the child about what should be concerning or not. A lot of times we're dealing with these kind of curves too, these curves that are far below the chart. And so if you just had a kid who came to the office, who came to see me, for example, with a dot sitting here at the 3rd percentile for height, that might be concerning, or that might not be concerning, because it depends really where they're at prior. So if you have a kid who followed those white dots, who have always been on the 3rd percentile their entire life, that's much more reassuring than somebody who's been much taller before in the past and has slid down the growth curve. They haven't been growing at the normal type of rate for somebody their age or gender. The normal growth rates in childhood is just something to think about. So kids, for most of their life here, are growing at around, on average, 2 inches a year. Some give or take there, but somewhere hovering around there. But young children and children in puberty grow at much more rapid pace than that, right? So, for example, which we'll talk about a little bit later, older kids, see, in particular with a lot of boys, who have delayed puberty, who are not going into puberty quite yet, look like they're starting to slide off the growth curve at around 12 and a half, 13. But really, as long as they're still growing at this 2 inches a year, that's okay. And they're gonna look like they're gonna fall off the growth curve because the growth curves were made on averages. And the average 13-year-old is growing around here. But if they're not yet in puberty, that's okay. Those kids have delayed puberty. We'll talk a little bit about that in a bit. So what factors control growth? I'll do this quickly. So because it's different depending on the age, but there are some constant factors here. In particular, number one is nutrition. So nutrition plays a huge role in modulating and keeping sustained normal linear growth through childhood, infancy, adult, you know, into adolescence. In infants, it's not really growth hormone, and we'll talk a little bit more about growth hormone toward the end, which tends to be a lot of reason why people come to see me. It's really nutrition and glucose insulin is the biggest thing. So for example, children who are born to moms who have diabetes, or gestational diabetes, right, who might be exposed to a lot of insulin because the moms are making a lot of insulin to keep their blood sugars normal, those kids tend to be born very large. That's an effect of that insulin getting into the baby and causing some growth. As the kids get older, nutrition and thyroid hormone plays a big role. And then through childhood and adulthood into adolescence, it's the growth factors and the growth hormone that plays a big role, still along with nutrition, obviously. And then during puberty, it's the sex steroids that really cause that acceleration in growth. Testosterone in boys and estrogen in girls. So we'll talk a little bit about kind of some variations of normal growth, okay? And number one is genetic short stature. So if the family is small, we should really consider that it's normal for the child to be on the small side. Makes sense. So these are kids who are short but appropriate for their family heights or their parental heights. Their bone age, which I'll show you a slide, bone age is an x-ray of the left hand and wrist. What that's showing us is that's showing us the maturity of their skeleton, how open their growth plates are or not. And from that x-ray, what we can see is we can see a projection about what we think they're going to grow towards once they are done with their growth. Boys will grow until their bone age is around 16, and girls until their bone age is around 14, but not everybody hits that when they're 16 or 14. If you have delayed puberty and you're a late bloomer, right, you might not hit that bone age of 16 until you're 20. You might be growing for many, many years, right? So getting that x-ray sometimes from an endocrine perspective is helpful to kind of think about a projection in the future. And these kids tend to have normal timing of puberty. They're kind of growing where they're supposed to on the chart, but maybe shorter than average. So this is an example. Let's say you have a dad who's 6 feet and a mom who's 5'3". So a dad who's taller than the average male, which is 5'10", and a mother who's slightly shorter than the average female, which is around 5'4". And so this is a calculation that we do to kind of calculate what's called the mid-parental height, taking the parents' heights into consideration and finding an average. You have to correct for the correct gender. So if this was a boy, the mid-parental height would be sitting somewhere around 70 inches, 5'10". and a girl would be sitting somewhere around 65 inches, which is around 5'5". And you see these brackets here, right? So these brackets are what we call the target height. So not everybody gets the exact midpoint of their parents, obviously, right? You get some smaller genes from somebody, end up a little bit smaller. Some taller genes from somebody, end up a little bit taller. They might be tall grandparents or short grandparents. All of that plays a role. So there's a range around 3 to 4 inches either way. And again, all of that is normal. If you think about my kids at the beginning, my oldest two, so I'm 5'9", my wife is 5 feet. And so he's growing around that third, fourth or so percentile, much more in line with kind of his mom's genetics. And my daughter is growing at the 60th or so percentile, much more in line with my family's genetics. All of those are wide ranges of normal. The treatment for short stature is nothing. There's nothing to do because nothing's wrong with the kid. And what you really should do, and what I try to do, is to reassure the family and reassure the kid that they shouldn't be worried, they shouldn't be anxious, they shouldn't be nervous. And a lot of what these visits turn into is kind of supporting and advocating for their height and not thinking about what the good things or the bad things about being short or tall are, right? And that if you're smaller than average or taller than average, it's okay, it doesn't matter. Focus on the positive things. Focus on the things you have control over a lot of the time. This is another example of somebody whose target height was down here at around the second or so percentile. And you can see through the length of their growth, they grew right along that second or so percentile pretty consistently. And there's nothing to do for that. To jump ahead on the slides a little bit, growth hormone really wouldn't have that much of an effect on that kind of kid. They're growing in accordance with their genetic potential. In terms of crossing percentiles, like that slide that we showed with the two different kind of paths. So crossing percentiles is usually, for an average age, school age kind of kid, not normal. But young babies often cross percentiles, because they're kind of finding where they're supposed to be on the curves. And older kids, right before they hit puberty, usually do a little bit of some crossing. That's kind of par for the course in a lot of kids. But most kids, school age, really should be maintaining their height percentiles. And if you see that your child is sliding off the curve, sliding down off the charts, that might be cause for an evaluation. This is the other thing that I was talking about, late bloomers, constitutional delay. So these are kids who are, you know, normally proportioned, have a slightly, you know, maybe a little bit, for the most part, a normal looking growth rate. There tends to be a family history of late bloomers. So dads who grew really late, mothers who had very late onset of periods. It's hard to a lot of tag dads down a lot of the time to figure out if they were late bloomers or not, unless it was very, very far off from average. A lot of dads don't remember, but this does run in families. Their bone ages tend to be delayed, and their maturity in terms of puberty tends to be delayed. And again, like I said before, right before the time of puberty, when they should be accelerating their growth, if they're not accelerating their growth because they're just a late bloomer, they're going to start to slide off the chart until they make a recovery, and I'll show you that recovery. The treatment is really patience, okay? Mother Nature takes its course, and things will happen eventually in most of these kids. There might be a role sometimes in giving, especially the boys, a short course of testosterone to kind of jumpstart their puberty, to get them moving. These are boys who might be really quite old, 14, 15, and not yet in puberty. And there is some psychosocial implications to that, some stress that they might be going through, feeling like they look very immature compared to their peers. And you can give them a short course of testosterone. It's a shot every month for around 4 months to try to kickstart their own body's puberty development. So here's somebody's growth curve, right? So growing towards the bottom of the chart, again, around the third percentile or so. And then here's somebody who has genetic short stature, right? They're just kind of destined to be in this range. Their family's on the shorter side. They're on the shorter side, nothing wrong with that, and they follow their curve towards the completion. And then compare that to somebody who has constitutional delay. So this is somebody who might have had taller parents, right? And this kid is growing shorter, so that might have been a concern. They fell off the chart during the typical age of puberty, but then they grew later and longer than the average person and got to where they need to get to. So I kind of talk about this in business as like the tortoise and the hare. So delayed puberty kids are like the tortoise. It's slow and steady. Right? And so they get there with time. They grow longer than the average person. Again, for girls, it's around an average age of 14 is when these curves start to level off. And so they've grown for longer than that and have made their way up to where they need to get to. We judge that really on the basis of that x-ray, which is there. So these are boys' hands, 8 years old, 13 and a half, and 16. And this is just to kind of show you what we're looking at. If you see all these open, big black spaces in between the bones that kind of look like almost breaks, those are all the growth plates. And as you get older, those growth plates get slimmer and slimmer until if you have 16, they're basically all gone. So we use the hand as a representation of the body to kind of judge whether or not there's still room for growth or not. But on average, boys are done at around 16 and girls are done with their growth at around age 14. So that's why the kind of the company line is, if you're concerned about growth and you're worried about growth, really the earlier, the better, right? That kind of gives you extra time to deal with concerns if they really are there or not. I tend to see a couple kids a year who are like boys who are already, you know, 17 or so and have facial hair and a deep voice and have gone through puberty and are still very concerned about their height. And unfortunately, there's nothing to do to really fix it. Once you're done with your growth, you're done with your growth. And then we'll talk a little bit about some endocrine disorders that have to do with growth and development. So hypothyroidism. So a big tenet of kids who are short, if you are, gaining weight, if you are gaining weight rapidly as a child and you are also not growing, that is a concern. That can often be an endocrine disorder, okay? Hypothyroidism, low functioning thyroid is one of those concerns. But the flip side of that, if you are gaining weight as a child and you are growing really well, normally or even better than normal, that is usually not a hormonal problem. That's usually not a thyroid issue. That's usually not a steroid overdose, or steroid excess or things like that. That's usually calories, exercise, okay? So hypothyroidism comes along with growth failure and weight gain. These kids may feel tired, may develop a large goiter, a large thyroid gland in the neck, and many, many other kinds of vague symptoms, constipation, dry skin, hair falling out, things like that. Many times though, they have nothing, and they come because they're not growing well. And part of our initial evaluation in terms of when we think about labs to send or studies to do for kids with short stature, we check the thyroid tests, and lo and behold, they're abnormal. This is somebody, it's hard to probably to see from where you're at, but somebody who had very marked growth failure, and then this arrow shows where they were started on Synthroid, on thyroid hormone replacement, which is a tablet that you take once a day, and their growth recovered right back up to on the chart where they were supposed to be. Interestingly, this kid's weight really was not much of a problem, right? So again, the main symptom of hypothyroidism really is oftentimes nothing, okay? Maybe the second main symptom is growth failure. The weight gain that kind of we think in the general population that goes along with a low functioning thyroid is really not super, super common in pediatrics, certainly. Puberty. So we talked a little bit about delayed puberty, but there are kids who don't go into puberty at all due to some kind of disorder, okay? And those commonly are certain genetic disorders like Turner syndrome or Klinefelter syndrome or autoimmune gonadal failure where the body kind of attacks either the testicles or the ovaries in the same way that you would be fighting off an infection, fighting off a bacteria. They fight off our own bodies. These are all autoimmune disorders. The treatment for these kids are similarly our sex steroid replacement. So testosterone can be given in injections or topical creams, and estrogens can be given as birth control pills, or classically now, we give it through an estrogen patch. The flip side of delayed puberty or no puberty is advanced puberty. So advanced puberty, what these kids do is they're going into puberty quite early, they're accelerating their growth quite early, they're growing really, really well, and then they're going to be done really soon, right? So they don't make it to that 14 or 16 mark. They're done with their growth very early. These are what we consider early is girls who are having any breast development earlier than 8 years of age, or any boys who are having any testicular enlargement earlier than 9 and a half years of age, okay? Sometimes I see kids for hair, right? Early hair growth, underarm hair, pubic hair, early body odor, early acne, things like that. Those things we tend to think about kind of in the community as all puberty, right? All that is together as puberty. It's really two separate but related ideas. So usually hair growth, acne, body odor is not true puberty. It doesn't go along with growth acceleration, okay? So if your kid is growing really, really fast, that's maybe more of a concern than if they have a little bit of pubic hair, okay? Oftentimes, early pubic hair, early acne, early underarm hair, early body odor. When we do our workups, we make sure that there's no hormonal imbalance, but oftentimes it's not much of anything, and those kids just get watched over time. Cushing syndrome, steroid excess. So you can get extra steroids in your body from either your body is making it too much on their own, which is a condition called Cushing syndrome, where kids gain a lot of weight and also stop growing, or because they're taking steroids for any kind of medical reasons, whether that be frequent asthma exacerbations, whether that be juvenile arthritis situations, whether that be transplant, whether that be inflammatory bowel disease patients. Extra steroids can cause growth failure, certainly. Now, there sometimes might not be much to do for those kids, especially if they need these medications for their health, right? If they have Crohn's disease and they need to be on steroids and they can't do any other options, then you kind of have to deal with that the best you can. But there might be other agents that the other doctors that are treating them for whatever they need those steroids for might be able to use. Kids who have severe asthma, the best thing to do for those kids is to try to prevent frequent exacerbations of their asthma, to try to make sure that they're taking their maintenance medications, to try to make sure they're avoiding triggers for their asthma exacerbations. The best you can keep kids off of oral steroids, the better the height outcome will likely be. But there are kids who need to take inhaled steroids for other reasons, especially asthma. The effect of that on growth tends to be pretty small. And sometimes I'll have questions asked of me like, well, you know, they're supposed to be on inhaled steroids for their asthma, but I'm worried about their growth. You know, do you think that we should stop that and see? And I say that if keeping them on the inhaled steroid is keeping their asthma at bay and keeping them well controlled, it's better that they're on that than needing frequent doses of oral steroids every few weeks because their asthma gets out of control. The effect on growth is pretty minimal, maybe around a half an inch to an inch, but it's nothing that is observable. Like if you're supposed to be, air quotes, 5'9", and you're 5'8½ now because of your prednisone, but it kept you out of the hospital from your asthma and it kept you from taking a lot of oral steroids, that's fine. No one's going to know 5'8½ to 5'9". And again, to compare, obesity due to calories, due to excess eating, due to insufficient exercise, things like that, does not go along with growth failure. So those kids tend to be growing still pretty normally. We kind of talked about that, so I'll skip it. In terms of other medications, just on a medication note, I get a lot of questions about this as well, behavioral medications, kids who have ADHD or anxiety disorders or things like that. Should they be on those medications? Will it affect their growth or what? So the biggest effect of medications, especially the stimulant medications, tends to be on an appetite suppressive level, right? So those kids tend to not be so hungry when they're taking their meds. If you don't gain weight well, your body uses calories as the building blocks for growth. So if you're not eating enough, you're not going to grow well enough. It's like putting gas in your gas tank, I say, right? If you're not putting enough gas in there, the car's not going to go. So sometimes tricks to do that is try to get a bigger meal at the beginning of the day before they take the medication, or to make up for whatever calories they're not eating during the day at nighttime when the medication wears off. For kids who don't need to take the medication every single day, can skip weekends, can skip the summer, and still do well, then sometimes that's an option. But if kids really need to be on those medications for the sake of their education, for their socialization, for things like that, they should be on those medications. Similar to inhaled steroids, these behavioral medications on their own, even with the best nutrition, might have a small effect on their growth, but again, that effect is very small. Again, around a half an inch to an inch. So I'd rather they do well in school, feel socialized, be happy, have friends, have good academics, all that stuff, and maybe miss a half an inch of height. Because really, I think, what is the bigger, best effect? It's that other stuff. Uncontrolled diabetes, I threw this in here because I would feel badly if I didn't have a slide about diabetes in every single lecture of mine. But uncontrolled diabetes can cause growth failure as well. It's a rare complication of uncontrolled diabetes. And the treatment is to try to work better under control. And then lastly, the biggest thing, and probably the biggest concern overall, is growth hormone deficiency. Okay, so by far and away, kids who come to me for short stature, the children themselves or the parents are most interested in, is growth hormone effective? Is it going to work for my kid? Should they be on it? Et cetera, et cetera. So to talk a little bit about growth hormone. So growth hormone comes from the pituitary gland, that's what that is, and along with a lot of other hormones. The biggest deal with growth hormone is that it is made most during puberty. Over the course of our life, it comes out as pulses, right, as bursts. Those bursts tend to be biggest and longest in our sleep. So the old wives' tale of or what my mother used to say is like, get good sleep, right, because you'll grow better. It's true. The better sleep, the longer, deeper REM sleep you have, the bursts of growth hormone tend to be more longer lasting, tend to be more sufficient. So getting good rest at night is important. The main cause of growth hormone deficiency out of all the kids that we see in endocrinology tends to be isolated, meaning there's no other hormonal deficiencies, it's just growth hormone, and it's idiopathic, meaning there's nothing wrong with the brain, they don't have a brain tumor, they don't have anything wrong with their gland at all, it's just there, we don't know why. Likely what it is that the brain is making some pituitary growth hormone, but not enough to sustain really good substantial growth, in particular, the growth that's needed during puberty, right? The sex steroids, testosterone, and estrogen work together with growth hormone during puberty to really give that great growth spurt where boys are growing like 4 inches a year, maybe 5 inches a year, right? You need both of those hormones together in concert to do well. The physical findings of growth hormone deficiency, again, tend to be nothing. There's nothing wrong with them physically. Very rarely we see kids who have other midline issues, other midline brain deficits, a single central incisor, which is a single tooth in the middle rather than two teeth in the middle, abdominal wall defects, genital defects, but this is extremely rare. Kids with growth hormone deficiency look completely normal. They look like any other kid. They're just not growing well. The labs that we send are these growth factors. Because that bursts of growth hormone like I talked about, it's hard to measure a random growth hormone level. It's like hitting the lottery. You have to have very kind of great timing to catch that good level. So we send these other tests. But sometimes kids need what is called a growth hormone stimulation test, where we give them medicine to make their body generate as much growth hormone as it can, so over the course of a couple of hours in the office, and we see how high of a level they can make under the influence of these medications. That's how you diagnose growth hormone deficiency. And then when can you treat, which is really the ultimate question. So there are really clear indications for who and who might not need growth hormone, okay? Growth hormone really is FDA approved for certain medical conditions. The biggest one is growth hormone deficiency. If you're not making enough growth hormone, clearly it makes sense that if you replace it, you should improve your growth back up to normal. And again, in theory, the earlier you treat, the better chance you have to recover that growth. What I really think is that as long as you can get to somebody before they're in puberty, you stand a really good chance of getting back onto the chart where the kid is supposed to be. There are other rare disorders that are approved for growth hormone deficiency, like Prader-Willi, Noonan syndrome, Turner syndrome, things like that. And then there's this catch-all diagnosis, idiopathic short stature. So idiopathic short stature just means you're going to be short. We don't know why. There's no reason. Your tests are all normal. You're making growth hormone, but you're just going to be short. So what we consider short in medical parlance really is boys whose predicted final height is less than 5'3". And girls whose predicted final height is less than 4'11", okay? And the reason why that has been chosen as this cutoff is kind of arbitrary, okay? There's no real great reason for those numbers, but that's the numbers that are FDA approved. So you can use growth hormone in those kids. It's an approved indication. The gain of height tends to not be as great as kids who are growth hormone deficient. So kids who are growth hormone deficient really improve their growth remarkably with a fairly low dose of growth hormone. Kids who are just short stature, on average, over the lifespan of treatment, which might be many, many years, on average, they gain around 1 to 1.5 inches. Some might grow no better. Some might grow much better. But the average is not that great. So what I tend to do is, if they meet those requirements, right, and those requirements, again, are predictive of that bone age x-ray, that's how we make that judgment call, I will treat them for around at least a year. Try to see if there is improvement, okay? And if there's really no improvement, no real improvement in the growth velocity, they're not making their way back to the chart, then there's a discussion that needs to be made, and that should we continue, is this really worth it? Because growth hormone is given as a daily injectable medication. So it's a drag to have to be on it, right? There's no other way to give it, it's injectable, it's a small needle. These are an example of types of pens that are used. I blocked out the names, I'm not advocating for anything over the other. But these are similar to like insulin pens with a small little pen needle that gets screwed on the top. And there are some side effects of growth hormone. It's not a benign medication. So the biggest things are local site injection problems, like some bleeding or some bruising or things like that, but nothing too terrible. Kids who are already overweight or already obese before their growth hormone starts, who are already at a risk for things like early type 2 diabetes, you know, weight-related diabetes, adult type diabetes, and they're already at risk for a thing called a SCFE, which is a slipped hip joint. growth hormone can kind of precipitate those to the surface sooner than it would otherwise have come on. For kids who have scoliosis, since this is going to make you grow, you can grow into the curvature of your spine potentially, so we monitor the back and things like that. And then this very, very rare side effect is intracranial hypertension, which is increased pressure around the brain. Those kids can sometimes get headaches or blurry vision, and so that resolves if you stop treatment. I put these two on here not to scare anybody, but these are kind of potential real things, tumors and cardiovascular issues. So there was a big study that came out a couple of years ago now looking at the effect of growth hormone treatment now 20 years down the line, right? What happens to people who were treated as children now that they're older? And there was a potential association between growth hormone treatment at high doses, like that idiopathic short stature dose that you need to try to get as much growth out of these kids as you can, and abdominal tumors and strokes. And again, these people now in their like late 20s, early 30s. So again, I think that for kids who are growth hormone deficient or who have these genetic syndromes, I think the benefit outweighs the risk. I think there's clear evidence that growth hormone works. It's safe at those kind of doses. But for kids who are just short, people who are coming in because they're going to be 5'6", they don't like 5'6", you know, because that's just something's wrong with 5'6", if something happens, I don't know what it is. You really have to have a conversation about what the expectations are, right, and what the risks of treatment might be. And so the expectations would be that if you're not growth hormone deficient, the average gain in height is on average around an inch over a lifetime of treatment. So if you're going to be 5'6", and now you're going to be 5'7", how does that change you? How does that make you feel different? Doesn't make you feel different, right? Oftentimes, the answer is no. Oftentimes, people come in having an idea of what growth hormone does and that it's going to just make you taller, potentially, forever, right? So growth hormone really will get you to your genetic potential. If you're, you know, if mom is 5 feet tall and dad is 5'6", and you're projected to be 5'6" like dad, but you want to be 6 feet tall, it's not going to make you 6 feet tall. It just doesn't do it. It doesn't work like that. Your body kind of has a set point for where it wants to be growing towards, and it should get to that point, hopefully, right? But if it's not in your genetic cards to be 6 feet tall, nothing's really going to be able to get you there, unfortunately. And so the moral of the story is that not all people need growth hormone, right? A lot of the time, this comes down to just having a conversation about what height means to people, right? And what, especially, I think, the boys tend to feel about what height means for their future, you know, for their, you know, relationships, for their friends, for their potential jobs and things like that. And really, if you look at studies that have looked at height outcome and salary and friends and being picked for middle school sports teams and all that stuff, there's really no association with that short people are worse than taller people or tall people are better than shorter people. But as a society, that's kind of how people think. So a lot of this comes down to having realistic expectations, always doing what's in the best interest of the patient in terms of a safety protocol, and really just supporting what their concerns are, and really talking about what those concerns are. And thank you for listening. They didn't want to listen to me watching television. Thank you.
President Grant.
President Grant was 5'3". Yeah, I mean, even, so that's a good point, is that, was it, I think it was Monroe or Madison, was extremely, extremely short. I mean, so even looking at presidents. Napoleon was actually not that short. I think Napoleon, so on French measurements, so people think he's short because, whatever it is, I don't remember. But I think he was like around like 5'7 or 5'8 or something like that, so not like super short. But yeah, even, but to your point, even presidents, where we think like presidential is like this tall, strapping guy, whatever, it's not really true. But this is a societal thing that we kind of structured for ourselves. So thanks.
Thank you.
I can't hand over to Dr. Rick.
So I'm going to go through my stuff relatively fast because Dr. Klein's a long talker.
Sorry.
I know, but I want to make sure we have time for questions because I think both of our talks, if they're going to do nothing else, are actually going to just, I think, stimulate a lot of questions. I'm happily 5'2". I think I'm pretty successful. I was not, you know, my mom's actually 5'7". My dad was 5'11", so clearly there was a grandparent somewhere. Either that or my parents were terrible and didn't take me for growth hormone. So I'm Dr. Greifer. I'm one of the pediatric GI doctors at NYU Langone. It's a great honor to be here. I actually was here a couple years ago. We did an abdominal pain discussion, and it's always a treat to work with our endocrinology colleagues because so many of the things that we deal with, the whole idea of growth and what's normal, what's not normal, is obviously something we work on together. So it's actually great, and it's such a great opportunity for you guys to actually have both perspectives to ask questions. And again, I think one of the things we see from Dr. Klein's talk, there's a very wide range of normal, and that's the key, is understanding what's normal and what's not normal. So I think certainly Dr. Klein would say, and I would say, I spend a good part of my visits reassuring parents that what you're seeing, even though you have a lot of anxiety that it's not normal, is actually completely normal. And again, there's not one, you know, one size definitely does not fit all if you leave here. That's the one thing you guys should leave here knowing. So just to go over, my first few slides are just basic sort of what to expect, how much to think about, because I think these are the things that I definitely get asked the most, both from pediatricians as well as from parents. And the first year of life is a period of very rapid growth. So just on average, a healthy one-month-old is going to grow about 1 centimeter a week and is going to gain about 20 to 30 grams a day, which is about a half an ounce to an ounce. That's not a lot. That's 2 tablespoons, just to put it into perspective. And then by a year, they're going to gain about half a centimeter, which is about a quarter of an inch per week, and about 10 grams per day. So again, very rapid in the beginning, and it starts to slow down. And that's where we get a lot of people somewhere between 9 and 12 months of age when their babies are not gaining an ounce a day all of a sudden. Is this a problem? And no, it is not. We're very happy. They're doing exactly what they're supposed to be doing. An average newborn weight is about 3.5 kilograms, which is about 7.5 pounds or so. That's average. Doesn't mean it's not okay if your baby's 6 pounds. Doesn't mean it's not okay if your baby's 9. We just have to come up with some numbers that are somewhere in the middle. And what we know is that the weight is usually doubled somewhere between 4 and 6 months of age. So again, you're born around 7.5 pounds. You may be about 14 or so pounds by 6 months of age, and tripled by 12 months of age. So, you know, usually that's what people will say. You'll have a baby born around 7 pounds. They're usually about 20, 21 pounds. Now, this is a very fun fact. I always love telling parents this. So if you had a baby who was born at 8 pounds and was 20 inches, just like sort of an average size, and continued growing exactly as they would grow in their first year of life, and they kept doing that, by the time they were 20 years old, they'd be 25 feet tall and 315 pounds. So again, remember, that's what's so key and that's what's so important, that first year of life. It's very different than I think, and Dr. Klein talked a little bit more about some of the older years. Things do change, but again, we focus so much on those beginning months as so key. So this is another one of my favorite slides, the size of an infant's stomach. So day one of life, your baby has a cherry. So this is what we'll start to see, and it grows relatively rapidly in the first month. So by day three, you have the size of a walnut, which is still less than an ounce. By a week, you have a size of an apricot, I guess an average apricot. I don't know if you're getting big apricots at like Whole Foods, but an average apricot, which is probably about 1.5 to 2 ounces. And then by a month, again, ranging in size from about 2.5 to 5 ounces. Remembering that a lot of babies are on the, you know, can still be small at a month of age. So keep in mind, when I have babies who come into my office and they're like, my baby is not taking 4 ounces every 2 hours. Well, thank God your baby's not taking 4 ounces, because it's not going to fit into the size of a large egg. That's the size of the baby's stomach. So important to look at, and I think I really like this slide because it just gives you a sense. You know, you assume, you hear these things, like, of course, a baby in a month is supposed to be taking 4 ounces, or is supposed to be spending, you know, 2 hours on my breast every hour. They're not going to fit it in, so. So the other thing about babies is they are actually smarter than you think. They don't do a lot. Their job is very minimal. Sleep, eat, poop, that's it. But the key is really trying to figure out what your baby does know. And what they do know is that they have their own sort of maximum limit or their own point where they're going to be finished. So a lot of the tough part is learning how to read your baby's cues and how to sort of respond to what they're saying. Certain signs of hunger, and this is not always a huge case, but again, just to look out for if they're new moms in the audience, is things like smacking their lips and sucking, you know, turning your head towards either your breast or, you know, towards a bottle if your bottle is like popping out of your bag, and oftentimes starting to put their hands to their mouth. Again, that's normal baby, not only reflexes, but normal baby responses to hunger. Another thing is these growth spurts, and this is another thing where parents will get a little bit anxious babies are going along, and then all of a sudden one day, they're crazy. They're eating every 5 minutes, they're cranky, they're unhappy, they're rooting, they're doing a lot of these hunger cues. And these growth spurts do occur several times in the first year of life, most often in the first 2 weeks, again at around 3 weeks to a month, again at 6 weeks, 3 months, and 6 months. So developmentally, this is for breastfeeding moms to stimulate more breast, more development of milk. But again, these are periods of time where the baby is going to have an increased caloric need. So there may be a few days in there where all of a sudden things that have been going very swimmingly all of a sudden aren't going as well for you. The other thing, and this goes back to that image of the little, you know, cherry to the egg size, is getting too much in the feeding. And this is where babies are smarter than we are. So sometimes they'll start pushing away or they'll start vomiting after a feeding. And again, it's just maybe a sign that they've taken too much in and that there's only so much they can hold. And again, not only reading the cues for hunger, sometimes they're not hungry. Sometimes it's a matter of a wet diaper, they're cold, they're hot, they need to be burped, or frankly, they just want to be held and they just want to be soothed. So a lot of the first couple of months of life is just sort of learning to read your own baby's responses and then again, responding to those needs. So talking a little bit more about the intake. So the average baby is going to consume about 2 to 3 ounces of formula per day for every pound. Does that make sense? So basically, maximums will be about 32 ounces in the day. Breastfed babies, not looking at formula feeding, will need to eat about every 2 to 3 hours. And I think the other key is that they consume about 90% of their intake in that first 10 minutes or so of breastfeeding. So again, another thing that I'll have moms will say, if you know, I'm on the breast for an hour, probably the last 45 minutes of that, you're working as your own pacifier. So we can fix that for you. But do remember, they're getting their intake in that first bit of time. And just going through just by age, because I think this is a little helpful, is somewhere in the first month of life, you're again thinking in terms of about a half ounce to an ounce, increasing up to about 3 ounces every 2 to 3 hours, and eating about 8 to 10 times a day. So in that first month of life, your baby's not going to be taking in 32 ounces. If they are, they're probably going to be seeing me or another gastroenterologist for vomiting all over the place. And then between 1 to 3 months, again, it's still going to be that every 2 to 4 hours, but about 3 to 4 ounces. And I think my rule of thumb that I'll tell most parents is, you have a 1 to 2 month old, they're taking about 1 to 2 ounces every 1 to 2 hours. You've got a 3 to 4 month old, they're taking about 3 to 4 ounces every 3 to 4 hours. So it's just not necessarily a hard rule of thumb, but just something to keep in the back of your head, because again, a lot of times parents are convinced they need to be taking 5 ounces every 2 hours. That's not necessarily the case. When babies are ready to eat solids, I think that's a question that pops up. And one thing I can tell you is the American Academy of Pediatrics has sort of vacillated over the past several years, 4 months, 6 months, 8 months, 3 months, all over the place. I will tell you that my mom, when I had my kids, was like, why aren't you feeding them at 1 week? Why are you not giving them a lamb chop at 1 week of age? I'm like, people come and see me for this. Please do not be giving my baby a lamb chop. But definitely things have changed. But I think the important thing to know is that while babies may be starting solid foods, they're not getting, and we were just talking about this, solid foods are really about teaching and socializing babies about how to move their mouth muscles and things like that. They're still really getting the vast majority of their nutrition and their growth from the calories they're getting from either breast milk or formula. But in general, most of these babies will be probably around 28 to 32 ounces of formula a day when they're getting ready to start the solid foods. At this point in time, again, you'll see that the amount of formulas will change. They'll be eating less times a day, from that 8 to 10 times a day, probably to about 5 times a day. And the volume, again, here, babies may drink less as they're eating more solids just by virtue of the fact that they're getting full. So don't expect them to still be taking 32 ounces if you have them up to taking 1 to 2 ounces of solid foods 3 to 3 times a day. When you hit 12 months of age, in general, your volume is going to significantly decrease. By 1 year of age, they're definitely going to be eating more solid foods. And so usually your big number of, 28, 32 ounces, probably going to head down to about 16 to 18 ounces. And I think that's a number where you start getting a little scared. You're, spending all this time on formula or breastfeeding. The amount of time on the breast, and again, the amount of volume of formula will significantly decrease once you kind of hit that 1 year age and a little bit older.
So toddler feeding, and I think this is where it can be a challenge. I don't know how many people have toddlers at home. The transition from a baby when you've got this very captive audience to a toddler who all of a sudden sort of is like on the move can be very, very challenging. But again, their needs are still pretty high at this point, and it's important to make sure that they're getting appropriate types of foods and appropriate variety. So you always want to keep some healthy foods on hand, whether it be healthy snacks, making sure obviously not choking hazards. Small portions are going to be important, and again, reading the cues of your toddler are also important. So I usually suggest these 5 to 6 small meals. It's probably about the same as when you were breast or bottle feeding, but you're going to be introducing solids kind of at each of those meals again, just to make sure that they're developing the oromotor tone. You want to offer things like praise and hugs and fun activities instead of food. One of the things I don't think either of us addressed, and we can certainly answer questions about, is how much is too much food, or talking a little bit about obesity or when babies are a little bit too big. So if you guys have questions about that, please save that and please ask us afterward. But the key is also making sure that we're not offering liquids more than solids, because that's another thing we can run into with babies is, you know, if you're going to give them 5-6 ounces of whole milk, it's going to be hard for them to sit down and eat more of their solid food. So you want to just make sure that you're not offering liquids all the time. Your baby is unlikely going to be dehydrated. That's always the key. Everyone's always concerned, is your baby going to be dehydrated? Remember, they probably only need about 16 ounces of hydration or liquid throughout the day. Juice, I get this question a lot, but I think honestly important to know there's no nutritional value for juices. I don't have an issue for flavor if people want to put a little color into their water. But again, as far as anything else, if you do want to add juice, you want to keep it to 4 ounces or less in the full day. And the other question that comes up a lot is the idea of using whole milk versus skim or 2%. Definitely up through age 2, whole milk is going to be key for brain development. So they really need that full fat up until that age to make sure that all of the neurons are being developed by their coatings. One of these other things we talked about is, you know, making sure that toddlers, again, oftentimes just have their own mind. They're starting to exhibit some of their independence. So don't be surprised if a toddler rejects a food the first couple of times you add it. Don't give up. You can pull it away for a day or two, but don't just assume because they don't like it the first time, they're never going to eat it again. This one you guys should have actually in your handout, and I won't go through this, but it's sort of a great little daily food plan and a great general guide to look at, sort of how much you need of each food group, fruits, vegetables, grains, proteins, and dairy. And this is just a nice little thing. There's a lot of these things on the internet, but again, that should be in your handout. So just to review a couple of common GI conditions that can affect growth in children. Like I said, part of the joy of being a gastroenterologist is I see a lot of normal kids, so I can tell how great and wonderful your kids are, but there are certain conditions that we obviously do need to look out for and we do need to rule out as physicians. So one of the first ones, and I'm certain that it will definitely spark a lot of questions, is gastroesophageal reflux, or GER. This is, just by definition, the bringing up of stomach contents up into the food pipe, or what we call the esophagus. If you leave here knowing something, or at least nothing else, almost everyone refluxes. And by saying almost everyone, it's pretty much everyone. It's just a physiologic, appropriate thing that infants do. But the key for us as physicians is figuring out what is abnormal reflux versus normal physiologic baby reflux. So for us, these are the questions we ask, and it's what we call a clinical diagnosis, meaning that in the vast majority of cases, we don't need to do much more other than spend some time with families and get a good history. So the question is, how often is the baby refluxing? Is the baby spitting up a couple of times a day after meals with a burp, or is it happening 100 times a day? Is there discomfort with it? Do you have babies who sit there, will spit up, and they're just happy as a clam, what we call our happy spitters, versus babies who are crying, miserable, just really unhappy with spitting up? Weight gain or loss is a very key thing. I tell all of my patients, if you walk into my office or you're carrying your baby and your baby is breathing, I don't really care much about the heart rate or anything else, but the most important signs that I'll get from my nursing staff is the weight and the height, which really tell me a great amount about what the body is doing and is the body working. And then again, going back to these breathing problems, like is the baby, you know, vomiting so much that they're having difficulty breathing or wheezing or anything else like that. So what we know about the natural history of reflux is that most babies get better somewhere between 15 to 18 months of age. And in general, most people will see that the symptoms start to get better just as you go through the first year of life. So by the time the baby is sitting up, by the time the baby is starting to get solid foods, in general, what used to feel like 100 times of vomiting a day, now all of a sudden is a few times a day. In our older children, so toddlers or even school-age children, or again, even older, the symptoms are oftentimes different. It may not be vomiting, but they will be complaining about stomach pain, sometimes chest pain, food coming up into their chest or their mouth. They can have difficulty swallowing, they can cough with food. So again, we do spend a lot of time with our patients and a lot of time with our families trying to get a sense for what the complaints are and how they're presenting. I talked about how the diagnosis is based mostly on symptoms and physical exam. And the treatment, in again, the vast majority of cases, is really diet related. We're adjusting the types of foods they're eating, we're adjusting the amount, the volume. Sometimes we're thickening foods in our infants. Occasionally medications are needed. I think, again, the key is finding out a little bit more about what's causing the issue. So celiac disease, which is something we're hearing a little bit more about lately, and what that is an autoimmune disease that causes damage to the finger-like projections, which are known as villi in our small intestine. Those villi are responsible for the absorption of calories and nutrients. So once your body starts seeing those things as foreign, and when you are eating gluten-containing foods, you'll get damage to the lining, making it harder for your body to absorb the needed nutrients. Patients who may be at higher risk are patients, again, with some of our endocrine conditions, such as diabetes and thyroid disease. And the starting here that I said is there is definitely a genetic predisposition. So if there are first-degree family members or other family members with celiac disease, that's going to be sort of a red flag for us to look a little deeper, especially in a patient who hasn't been gaining weight well or has had difficulty growing. One thing we know is that it is a lifelong condition, so once you have celiac disease, you have it forever. But in one of the joys about being able to diagnose someone with a condition and be able to treat them with 100% diet control. You do not need medications, you do not need chemotherapy, you do not need surgery, you don't need anything other than diet modification. So easier said than done, but again, it is something that's curable and something that's able to be maintained and can be cured and healed. When we talk about gluten, a lot of people ask what that is, and basically it's the protein found in the particular family of grains in wheat, rye, and barley. And the symptoms can range from anywhere. One thing I often tell families is celiac disease is kind of the great sort of, like, it presents in any different way. I've had a patient present with not much more than fainting. I've had a patient present with seizures. I've had morbidly obese patients with horrible constipation present with celiac disease. But again, the more classical old way of people would be kids who had growth failure with a lot of diarrhea. But again, any kind of GI disturbance for us is going to be a trigger for us to look a little bit further. Diagnosis for us starts off with screening blood tests, so there are special lab tests that we can send off, and it does need to be confirmed at this point in time with an upper endoscopy, which is an invasive procedure where we have to take a look with our camera. Again, the treatment, like we talked about, is gluten-free diet, and again, be happy to answer, because this is, again, is one of those topics that people often have a lot of questions about. So, inflammatory bowel disease. This is very different than irritable bowel syndrome, which I will not discuss in this talk because that actually will have no effect on growth. But inflammatory bowel disease is a long-term chronic inflammatory condition that can affect the gut basically anywhere from your mouth all the way down to your bottom. So there are two types or two families called ulcerative colitis, which will affect your large intestine or the colon only, or Crohn's disease, which again can affect anywhere from your mouth all the way down, anywhere in your stomach, your small intestine, and even what we call extra intestinal manifestations. So some people may have rashes, some people can have disease right outside their anus. The most common time when this is actually diagnosed is teenage years, but lately we've actually seen some younger patients presenting even as early as 2 and 3. It tends to be more common in certain families, and it's not contagious, which is important to know, but there is some sort of genetic predisposition. Just because one family member has it does not mean the other family member will have it. And I think I always tell all of my patients that there have been long-term twin studies with identical twins, that one identical twin has gotten it and the other one never does. So we know those patients have exactly the same genetic components. So why one gets it and one doesn't is still a topic of research that's ongoing, and hopefully in the next bit of time we'll find out more about exactly sort of what the perfect storm that may cause inflammatory bowel disease in patients is. Symptoms again are different in the types that are there. In general, both will have diarrhea, but in ulcerative colitis, that's a real sort of very obvious finding. They'll often have blood in the stool, pain, and sometimes anemia from the blood loss and the frequent diarrhea. For Crohn's disease, you may see some of the same symptoms, such as diarrhea, pain, and weight loss. Most often, though, we will see growth issues with our Crohn's disease patients because it does often affect other areas, not just the large intestine. And when it does affect some of these other areas, they're going to have a more difficult time absorbing the calories like we discussed. Diagnosis is similar to a lot of our other things with a good history and physical. We'll often send off blood tests as well as some stool samples. And if we do have a high level of suspicion, we will go ahead and perform an endoscopy and colonoscopy to investigate directly the intestines from above and below. The treatment, which I won't go into, varies greatly as far as different types of medications, and that's a very large discussion that we can have a scope over about a two-hour discussion. But again, there are various ranges and ways of treatments, and actually with each month we're getting newer and newer treatments. And hopefully I can tell you that as the most recent gastroenterology conference, they actually are actively working on a vaccine for this. I think that actually is something that may be not in the next 2-3 years, but I think actually probably something in the next 10-15 years, which in medicine is pretty rapid. I think maybe something we'll be seeing. I won't spend too much time on this, but we did talk a lot about what babies are taking in. What does it mean for these babies to get out? And I think that's something that's probably also going to stimulate a lot of questions. Average bowel movements for an infant can range anywhere from 0 times every, or 1 time every 7 days to 7 or 10 times a day. As they get older and up through about age 5, we'll accept anywhere from 0 to about 5 sort of mushy bowel movements a day. And it won't be till probably around age 6 or 7 that we see more of an adult pattern with more formed stools somewhere between 1 to 3 times a day, even skipping days. And again, what's very wide range of normal, I think, is the best thing to say as far as that is. But chronic constipation can definitely affect growth, and that's not going to be surprising when we think about patients with infrequent bowel movements, hard bowel movements, and passing, you know, painful bowel movements for sure. It's slightly more in boys, sorry to say. It does often run in families, and again, probably related to the nutritional component within the family itself. And then we do see some issues with patients who have some developmental delays or even attention issues. We talked that normal bowel patterns can actually range sort of all over the place depending on their intake, formula versus breastfeeding, toddler diet, starch-heavy diets, things like that. Causes often, again, I think that diet might bolded it because I think that is probably the most significant factor. For us, the common time to see constipation is usually toddler ages when you're transitioning out of breastfeeding, formula feeding into more solid foods. And I don't know many toddlers who love a varied diet. I think most of my toddlers that I see definitely eat that brown beige diet. So if it's not brown or beige in color, they're not eating it. So it's like a chicken nugget, bread, pasta, rice, things like that. And maybe they get a few glasses of water a day, but they're probably not getting what they need to have those softer, easy to pass bowel movements. Symptoms are often things like pain, abdominal distension where their belly will get very full and hard. You may actually see blood in these bowel movements, especially if they're passing really large, voluminous bowel movements, and that's very, very scary, but again, nothing to be concerned about. Sometimes you can even see accidents in the underwear, and oftentimes, again, difficulty with toilet training, just a lot of anxiety around the bowel movements themselves. And that goes into the next, which is, again, the pain can cause withholding behaviors. Kids can't say a lot of things, so I always say, your 2 or 3-year-old is not going to be able to say to you, "Mommy, it really hurts me when I'm passing this bowel movement, so I'm going to avoid passing this bowel movement." But what you will see is a kid who will have a lot of these withholding behaviors. They'll do that dance where they're very agitated. You'll see them running into the corner of the room. And the most common thing that I'll have parents come and say is you can see them pushing and straining, but I've actually asked parents to do this, and most when they do it are completely surprised. When you see your baby straining and pushing, more often than they're not, they're actually holding in. So when you see them pushing and straining, if you try to separate their butt cheeks, they're actually holding it so tight they could probably crack a nut in between those butt cheeks. Diagnosis here is similar to all the things we do in GI, which is a good history and physical. We do need to do a rectal exam, which is oftentimes a source of great anxiety for families. But for us, it is important to make sure that the location of the anus is normal. There's not a big hard ball of stool that's sitting in there. There's no cracks or other things that may be causing additional pain to the patient. So that's really important for us. We very, very rarely do x-ray or radiology tests. I have a lot of families who are like, please, we need to image, we need to do this. And for us, again, we think about risks and benefits of everything we do, and there's not a lot of benefit to knowing if we can see from the history that the child is constipated. So treatment for this, again, is dietary with some behavior modification. Again, going over, reassuring the families, you know, working to help, you know, positive reinforcement for the children. And again, sometimes we do use other non-habit-forming medications, such as some softeners and stimulant laxatives to help these kids through this. All right, that's it. We'll open it up for questions.
Also, there is an evaluation in the folders, the blue sheet. Please fill them out on your way out and drop them off where you signed in. All right, so we'll take some questions. All right, there we go. Yeah,
okay, so for babies that have reflux, like once they burp, like my baby will eat after, is the burping bringing up acid?
So the only way would be able to go. So did everyone hear?
Yeah,
I can repeat.
I'll repeat that question. Okay. Yeah, so she just asked that, so if a baby who burps and then won't eat afterward, is it because they're bringing up acid? And I think just to, that, are they in pain or uncomfortable? And does that mean anything? So, you know, we do, obviously, all infants make acid. It's developed in our stomach, created in the stomach, and can come up. One of the things, though, that more likely happens with our infants is that what they're just bringing up is a lot of air, which can cause stretch of the food pipe, which can make them very uncomfortable, and sometimes there may still even be a little bit of air in there. Milk or formula, breast milk or formula, is a great sort of acid blocker unto itself. So it's unlikely that they're bringing up horrible sort of burning acid that's there. But if what you're saying happens and it becomes an issue where even when the next feed comes around and now all of a sudden your baby's refusing that next feed, that's when we start getting more concerned, as opposed to like them having a burp and stopping in general. Again, it's hard for us to know what's there, but as long as the time for the next feed comes around that they're able to go ahead and feed well and the weight gain is there and they're very comfortable otherwise, there's not much more we would do other than, again, making sure we're doing a good job burping.
Are you sort of like racing against the clock because kids are going into puberty so much earlier now? So like this.
Can you guys hear the questions? You want repeats?
No.
You guys here? Okay.
Like, how early is too early? And like, what if you miss the window? Because kids are. Like girls
are menstruating
and like
great question. Yeah, you know, it's a great question. It's a legit concern, right? Yeah, so the question is, well, do you feel like you're racing, or do I guess we as endocrinologists feel like we're racing against the clock, or do you as parents feel like you have to like get them to an endocrinologist very, very soon if you're at all, you know, concerned about growth or development? So the question is, to some extent, yes, you're right that the lower limit of normal of puberty has decreased over the course of many years, right? 8 for girls, 9, 9.5 or so for boys. For kids who do have significant growth failure, legit, real growth hormone deficiency, it's usually okay because those kids, again, even if you get them onto treatment by 10, 11, you know, they still grow well. There is some discussion about, do you put kids on pubertal blockers in addition to putting them onto growth hormone to try to sustain more of the openness of their growth plates to try to get even more growth out of them? Depending on what endocrinologist you ask, you may get a different answer, but since I have the pleasure of being here today, I guess I'll say that it's not indicated to block puberty. There are complications and side effects that go along with pubertal blockers. We don't know long-term effects of pubertal blockers. There might be a benefit, clearly, to having the growth plates be open, but again, that benefit is slight and maybe even questionable. So, in terms of the urgency matter, I think that if you're at all concerned about growth or development, if they're having failure off the growth curves, if they're sliding off, I think that that concern really should not necessarily be placed in context of where they are in puberty. I think if you're concerned about growth, that should be the concern itself. I wouldn't feel like you have to get somebody in by age 3 or by age 4 because if you don't, like, you're going to miss an opportunity. It's fine. Even if a kid is in puberty, it still is, for many, more than not, still fine to be able to do something.
Okay, I'm going to repeat that for everyone else.
Okay, just to follow that, but if there's no growth hormone deficiency,
yeah,
it's really, you're not doing, there's nothing to do.
There is, in sorry.
No, that's okay. She's asking if there is no growth hormone deficiency, is there something you can do?
Besides the GI, I guess, tests, celiac, etc.
Yeah, so I would say that in terms of reasons for growth failure, in terms of, if you want to treat somebody with growth hormone, you're right, growth hormone deficiency is the biggest cause. But there are other things that we look for, hypothyroidism, celiac disease, you know, other things that might be related to their growth failure that would still be important to diagnose and then treat in that avenue, you know. There are kids who come to me for growth failure that end up being diagnosed with celiac disease on my screening test, and then I send them to Dr. Greifer for you know, care. So there are things to do, but you're right, you know, to your point that if you're not going to treat somebody with growth hormone and everything else looks okay, it's unlikely that they need treatment, you know? Yeah.
Just to add more to that, though,
I think the other key is one of the most common reasons for growth failure, or at least some sort of maybe growth delay, is related to nutritional status. And so for us, the key, at least getting them activated, whether it be with a gastroenterologist or an endocrinologist, I think oftentimes is getting them involved with a nutritionist through our office or at least under our care, which allows us to make sure that we're meeting their nutritional needs. Kids actually need a fair amount of calories, and it's not always so easy. I mean, as adults, I think that we easily get too many calories. I think for a kid, when you really sit down and calculate out what they're getting in a day, oftentimes we're just not hitting that daily goal that we need to, and it can be tiny little tweaks that we can make which can make significant differences in their growth.
I'm
going to
hand you guys the mic. It's for the video, so we want to be able to hear you loud and clear.
Why is it that girls in this generation are going through puberty earlier? Are boys going through puberty earlier as well? Is this something that's only happening in America, or is it happening all over the world? Could this be attributed to the foods that we're eating, the hormones that are in the foods? Popular question.
You've clearly spoken to my mother.
Yes. Milk is different.
Yes, it's 100%. My mom, my Jewish grandmother around the Long Island, well, it's definitely the milk. It's the hormones in the milk.
Would we expect the future generations to be shorter because of this?
Excellent questions, and I'm gonna not give excellent answers. So in maybe different order than you asked them, but hopefully I'll touch on all of them. So the general age of the onset of puberty for both boys and girls has gotten younger and younger over the course of many decades now. And that's a worldwide phenomenon, not just in the US, but in the US seems to maybe be a little bit more than in other places. Also, there is a racial difference. So African American and Hispanic children compared with Caucasian or Asian also have an earlier onset of the age of puberty. It may be related to the hormone exposure, not just in food, in milk in particular, to tell your grandma, but also in other exposures like in plastics and other kinds of manufacturing items. Microwaving food in certain plastic containers can release certain phytoestrogens, which can mimic estrogen exposure in young children. But the lousy answer to your excellent question is we don't know really what is driving this phenomenon. Does it cause ultimately a short change in them in terms of height? The data doesn't necessarily support that. The average heights in terms of adult men and women are not getting shorter. And the average age in terms of you know, puberty in general, menarche in particular, girls having very early periods, is not drifting as low as the onset of puberty. So whereas the onset of puberty, breast development in particular in girls, right, is getting younger and younger, the onset of menarche, onset of the first period, is not getting as younger as quickly. So they're still spending a longer amount of time in the years of puberty. Did I hit all the questions?
Can I follow up? Okay. Just to make a little clear, because I know milk is a big concern. Black and white, do you think organic, less hormone milk is better or not?
And chickens.
No.
No? That's what we want.
My question's on the other side. A, how much could we put emphasis on hereditary, meaning myself being a late bloomer, my son who's 16 grew tall, but no facial hair, no anything like that. And he also says he doesn't have a desire, no appetite to eat. He's a slim kid, like most of my kids, and he's slight, and he doesn't have an appetite, and he wants to eat. He wants to bulk up, he's working out. What do I tell a child like that? He has hair, but nothing excessive.
So again, to remind that hair growth is not always pubertal related. Hair growth is also a lot of family related, right? Especially facial hair. There are some people who get a lot of facial hair quite young even. You know, there are boys who have a little bit of facial hair, girls who have a lot of body hair, who might not be hormonally driven, right? It's really not something that you would really know. It's testicular size and enlargement that's really created by puberty. A lot of it really is genetic. So in particular, if a parent is a late bloomer, then it is very high likelihood that one of their children might be a late bloomer. If the family is genetically slim, good for you. but that also might be part of it. Being slim though, being underweight, not maybe taking in enough calories, can also cause further delay of puberty. Because puberty is a high energy, high drive, high metabolism state. So if you're underweight because you're not eating well or something else is going on, your body puts puberty on hold because it wants to conserve energy to keep the calories that it is taking in for keeping your heart pumping, keeping your brain working, keeping your kidneys filtering. Your body, what I tend to say for kids who are not great eaters or not, you know, things like that, is that your body really doesn't care if you are 2 feet tall or 10 feet tall, but your body cares if your heart is working and your kidneys are working and your brain is working. So it'll divert energy towards that.
On the flip side, it's very concerning in our society and then all around is obesity. Mm-hmm. And you know, while we worry about short growth and things, we also how to handle that. You see a child getting, you know, an early age or a little bit older, but how to handle, you know, what to do and what to say to that child.
I think this, you guys had Laura Shammy here last month talking about it. I think besides a medical issue, the psychological, psychosocial issues surrounding obesity, I think is a big deal also. I think it will start in the home, not using words like you're so fat, don't eat that, but focusing and bringing healthier foods, healthier choices, and stuff. And then there is the medical concerns that do come into play.
If you'd like to expand on that.
Yeah, so I think that's really the key, and especially in today's society, I think the psychosocial impact of it is probably even greater. I would say in general, a lot of our obese kids often comes from households where other members of the family are obese. So it's not just about treating the child, it's really about making larger scale family changes and what's going on in the household. I think in a child who may be an isolated case where you do see slender family, or in general most of the family has a thinner look to it, we obviously want to rule out these other medical issues such as thyroid disease. We want to make sure there's nothing else going on from an endocrine standpoint, and then move on to the nutritional and behavioral things as far as making sure, again, on the flip side of saying, oh, you know, it's very easy to not get enough calories. In some households, it's very hard to get less calories, exactly. So when you start going through, and like I have patients who come into the office and, you know, like kids have snacks to keep them busy in the office, and I see kids coming in with, like, you know, the chips and the this, and they're, you know, they're giving them chocolate milk and they're giving them juice and things like that. They're, again, on the flip side to that, relatively easy to make some of those changes. But
it can't just be changing the child, it's really changing the whole sort of culture of the household.
Yeah, I'll be the third to agree about the psychosocial aspects of obesity. I think that what I tell families, and I tell in particular the kids themselves, is that it's not the dot on the chart that matters. It's not the actual number that matters. You know, we talk about obesity and weight, and I'm sure doctors show them on the chart, like, look how far off the top of the chart you are. I just don't think that helps. And I think that the obese pediatric and the obese adolescent population gets a lot of probably flack from their peers and flack from their school, and they're not eating because they want to do it. They're eating because there's something going on, or they're eating because this is how they're brought up, or they're eating because they have poor access to healthy food, or they're eating because it's not safe for them to go exercise somewhere, or there are other issues. So it's kind of what I talk about is that it's not the actual number, it's the effect on health. Now, thankfully, still the rate of type 2 diabetes, adult onset diabetes, it is relatively low in pediatrics compared to the adult population, certainly, but it's increasing, right? And we see a lot of abnormal liver function testing, fatty liver, vitamin D deficiency, you know, abnormal lipids at very, very young ages. So what I, from a practical standpoint, tell these families is that, you know, it's easy to take a pill, it's hard to change the way you act, the way you live, and the way you do things. So this is difficult. There are going to be setbacks, and that's okay. You're only human, you're normal. Congratulations on being normal. In terms of diet, the only restriction that I ever say is juice. I say that it's not healthy for me, it's not healthy for you, it's not healthy for anyone in this room. And that's the, or soda, you know, sweet drinks, essentially. Most people don't think about really what their intake of sweet drinks is, but those are also things like Gatorade, vitamin water, all that stuff too. People just think about like fruit juice and that's it, but it's a lot of other stuff. And then everything else is about balancing. It's usually about, I think, tackling the carbs first, trying to reduce carbs compared and portion size. But it's a process, and it's really trying to target roadblocks. It's really trying to engage the family, and sometimes I'll have to engage a social worker or a psychiatrist or therapist or certainly our nutritionist. Everybody needs to work together, and I think the best, most successful cases are the ones where the families kind of work in a supportive nature and work in kind of joint together, rather than the families who like, see, I told you not to drink that juice. I told you, you shouldn't be doing that. You're always going to the store after school. You know, that stuff usually sets up for problems. So it's a TLC.
I'll add one more thing to that and we'll go to the next. But I never put a patient on a diet. I think when you start using the word diet, it's got a real negative connotation for not only the kid, but for the family itself. And so the only goals I set are really legitimate goals. In the vast majority of our cases, I do not ask my patients to lose weight. I ask them to keep them at the exact same weight. So their only goal for the next visit is to come in weighing exactly the same as the visit they were at. Because ultimately, especially for our pediatric patients, if we can keep them at the same weight, we're actually doing as much for obesity as we are in saying, you've got to lose 5 pounds or you've got to lose 10 pounds. So for us, it's about setting really legitimate goals for them and not pressuring them to say, oh, you've got to meet this. You basically just have to maintain. I think that concept has really worked for most of my families and patients.
I got excited. No, it's true for our growing children, right? If you keep your weight the same as you grow, you're going to slim, right? It's like being stretched out, stretch Armstrong. So it works. For our older kids who are not growing, it's not going to change the BMI clearly if you could stay the same weight, but that's okay as a first step, right? To not gain another 10 pounds in 3 months, that's a huge, huge, huge first step. So again, it's a lot of supportive and help. So again, absolutely.
So given the range of issues that you've identified today, how good do you feel pediatricians are at identifying these issues? I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I really want to ask this.
Identify yourself.
And I'm from NYU. I will identify myself. But how good are they? Because I had a pediatrician who was a minimizer, and I've had friends who had pediatricians who were maximizers. And so for the parents here who may want to know, when do they call you? When do they reach out to a specialist? Can you just provide some context and guidance?
Great question. Stop with the great questions. I'll let you come.
going to quickly interject here. As a nurse, it's terrible, but I do whisper to patients on the side to be your own advocate and your child's own advocate. You know your children really well. You know that next day something's a little off. Yes, pediatricians do have a lot, you know, to give you and definitely take their opinion, but I do think in the end of the day, you need to advocate for your own child.
Yeah, so I have a very conservative pediatrician who gets very angry at me because I ignore a lot of the stuff. I'm like, eh, no, they're fine. But on the flip side, we do, and I think a lot of that is, and it's not to say anything about pediatrics, I think it's a reflection on the healthcare system nowadays. Our pediatricians are really stretched very thin, and when they can only spend 5 or 10 minutes with a family, it's virtually impossible for them to give the sort of anticipatory guidance or even really sit with families like I think we can as subspecialists to really give them what they need. So I think, again, to reiterate what she said, if you have concerns, you need to bring it up. If you feel that it's not being addressed, there's never, again, an issue with self-referring. And I get a lot of visits where they're like, my pediatrician didn't send me, I have concerns. Sometimes I pick up stuff, sometimes it's not much more than like, you know what, your pediatrician's doing a great job, I just want to reassure you that what it is normal. But again, I think just sometimes it's difficult in today's day and age to really necessarily feel like you're getting the directed, you know, focused care that you may need or want.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with all of that. I think to your point about minimizers or overdoers, I guess, you know, I guess we or I may not see those that get minimized, right? So on that front, I think that as parents, you know, in my family, I'm the minimizer. My wife is the, you know, Jason, stop it. Like, we have to do something. So I think as parents, if any parent comes to me and say, like, my pediatrician told me that this was nothing, but it's just, like, bothering me, I would never, ever fault a parent for ever, ever doing that. I think that it is our job to advocate for our own kids. And if you have a concern, then it makes sense to go to see the specialist. That's fine. I think that in terms of people who over-referrals for concerns about growth or really concerns that don't matter, I would say that, speaking generally, because it's hard to speak for every particular case, but if you are I see a bunch of patients like this who the family's not concerned. They know that they're a very short family and the kid is also on the short side and growing steadily, but the pediatrician is the one who is overly concerned. This happens a lot with patients who go to see all of a sudden a new pediatrician or who recently moved and is seeing a new pediatrician, and then all of a sudden it's the doctor that's concerned. You know, if the family's not overly concerned and they're growing steadily, I think that 9 times out of 10, those kids are fine. And it's just reassurance, but that's okay. Sometimes it's okay to just be reassured by somebody else. And again, to reiterate what Dr. Greifer said, I think that if you're at all concerned about the growth, the time spent in the pediatrician's office face-to-face with the doctor is smaller and smaller and smaller, and it's hard to make a good judgment call. And we do have the benefit of, as subspecialists, of seeing less patients per session and having more time to kind of sit down and schmooze. And we're both schmoozers, so.
just
me. So yeah.
And we're going to make our way around.
I'm going to start back here. I wanted to know what, as far as nutrition goes, what do we do with our children that are not growing the best and are not great eaters, have started like small appetites?
I mean, what I usually tell them, you can tell me if I'm wrong. I mean, this is a good learning exercise for me, too. You know, what I usually tell them is that it's maximizing calories and the amount of food that you're going to eat. You know, so if you don't have a big appetite, sometimes it can be quite stressful for kids to be told, like, you have to be eating, eat more, right? You finish this. And it's like the anxiety goes through the roof, right? So it's maximizing what they can eat. I'll do that ice cream thing at night. Do you recommend that at all?
Haagen-Dazs
ice cream before bed?
Highest calorie
right? They're not active at nighttime. They'll be sleeping on those calories, so then hopefully it'll kind of stick their bones in a way, but I'll let the expert.
Yeah, so that's like the world's greatest challenge. I actually had one of those kids, which was like, again, as a gastroenterologist, there's nothing more frustrating. I had like one kid who's a horrible constipator and one kid who's like just never ate ever. So I've been there as a parent as well as a gastroenterologist. So do as I say, not as I do. But I think, obviously, maximizing calories is the key. And I think that what I spend a lot of time with families talking about this, and my nutritionist does as well, is looking for those gateway foods. And when I say a gateway food, is a food that there's usually one or two foods that are oftentimes a slam dunk for a kid. Maybe they're not necessarily the foods that we would choose. Like, I don't necessarily, like, my kid would only eat mac and cheese. I would have three meals of mac and cheese a day and would have, like, three macaronis, and that was it. So it's kind of trying to find the foods that are successful and maximizing the calories. A lot of just enriching the foods that they're eating. So it doesn't have to be a volume thing. It's not like, oh, we need you to finish an entire bowl of pasta or macaroni and cheese, but maybe enriching what you've got there. So you've got macaroni and cheese, you can add a dollop of heavy cream. You could, again, in the milk, you can add heavy cream. You can do the ice cream, you can do shakes, you can do things like that. We do use a lot of nutritional supplements, such as Pediasures or, you know, Ensures or any of these nutritional drinks as an additive. I think one of the keys, though, is also looking at the behavior of the child. So a lot of times those kids tend to be more grazers, meaning they're eating like eight times a day because you're so anxious to make sure they get their calories throughout the day that they're just sort of snacking all day. The problem with that is you may not be generating the hunger for them to sit down at a meal. So like our nutritionist and us in general are pretty strict about doing three meals, two snacks, nothing else in between. So you're not like constantly chasing them with like a bowl of something or a cup of something, to really sort of generate the concept of like times when they're not eating, times when they're eating. So it's addressing a behavior too oftentimes.
Thank you.
So I have a question about the safety of the growth hormone. You said it's FDA approved on one hand. On the other hand, there's no long-term studies. So like, what do you, and say, you know, weigh the risks. So buy it.
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm gonna stay line on that. Is 1 inch ever worth a risk of a potential anything you listed on that list?
And what if you have four things on that list? And
Sure. For me, the bottom of the list was a little frightening.
But what you're saying is a real question, and it's a real concern for patients who need treatment. So something I didn't go into on that slide, I kind of touched on it verbally, but I did make it very clear, is that there are different dosing regimens depending on the indication for treatment, right? You're right that we don't have very long-term follow-up studies. We used to use cadaveric growth hormone extracted from pituitary glands of deceased people up until around the 1970s, early 1980s, and then we've been using synthetic growth hormone since then following. So the long-term studies are partially there, but we don't know what happens 50 years, 60 years, 70 years down the line. But all the evidence that we have, that we do have, from prior and from now with synthetic growth hormone, states to the fact that for children who have a real clear indication, who you could treat at a modest dose, you know, a middle to lower range dose, as you can for most kids who are growth hormone deficient, the risks during treatment are low. I have kids who don't have any problems, you know, whatsoever. I've had, of that intracranial hypertension, the increased pressure around the brain, I've had two kids who've ever had that. As for children who need to be treated at high doses, really those are kids who are making enough, but you're trying to really overload their body with more and more growth hormone to try to squeeze out as much growth as you can. Your concern is my concern, you know? And there are endocrinologists who will give growth hormone to every single person who walks through their door. That's not how I was trained, and that's not what I think the literature supports. I think that it supports being thoughtful about the risks and benefits of treatment. And so to your point, I think that if a child get a great growth response on growth hormone, and you can treat them at a reasonable dose, and you're monitoring their labs during treatment for any kind of interval problems, and you act accordingly, I think that, and you're operating within kind of the studied and accepted parameters, I think it makes sense. I think if you start that path, though, and the patient doesn't grow well, right, no one's going to come to your house and arrest you for stopping treatment. And so I tell families, there's no guarantee that you have to be on treatment for the length of the child's growth. You can stop if it doesn't work. And then if there's really no indication, no clear indication, I think that that's when the risks outweigh the benefits. You're right that we don't know long-term side effects for any of these cases. But that's true for a lot of things. And I think that you've got to take the patient on a patient-by-patient basis. And so for somebody who is too tall for short stature and healthy otherwise, I don't recommend treatment, and your concerns are my concerns.
I have another question.
Yeah, we have time for like a couple more questions.
Just said, like, quickly, he said that
yeah.
choosing the right doctor.
Sorry.
How do you choose the right doctor? Like,
I don't know.
Like, he says, I thought this would just give it.
So that was the question, how do you choose the right doctor?
I think referrals are always the best.
Because he said some doctors will just give it.
Yeah, I think that'd be okay.
And it's also depending on how you want to treat. Are you more conservative? Do you want aggressive treatment? And you find a doctor. I mean, it's terrible.
I think that your pediatrician, hopefully you have a good relationship with your doctor, your child's doctor, and they know you and how you think, and they know the people who are out there and can refer you to somebody who matches. But let's say you go to a doctor, an endocrinologist, and they say, oh my God, your kid needs to be on growth hormone right now, and that feels weird to you. Or if they say, your kid's fine, go away, I don't want to see you again, and that feels weird to you. There's no harm in seeing somebody else. I have kids who come to me for a second or third.
Also, insurance helps you make decisions.
Well, of course, my
insurance. All right, we have like maybe two more questions.
So a child who has a 9-year-old growth bone x-ray at 12, does it ever accelerate? Do you have to keep going to check on it? And also, you said hair isn't an indication for boys with puberty, so what would it be like and when should I be concerned? But also the child is always on that
the low curve of, like, the 5%. Mm-hmm. So having a delayed bone age is a preferable thing, obviously, right? It means more time for growth. The bone age doesn't follow the same tempo as chronologic age, right? So if it was 9 when it was 13, it's not going to necessarily be 10 when it's 14 and 11 when it's 15. It can catch up. It can lag further behind. What I tend to do for kids who have delayed bone ages or are following bone ages is annually, I'll do an x-ray to kind of re-up the high prediction and see what it's doing. In terms of hair growth, hair development, stuff like that, in boys in particular, hair growth, when it is hormonally driven, is driven by clearly testosterone, which most of it comes from the testicles during puberty, but prior to puberty is coming from the adrenal glands, which are the glands that live on top of our kidneys. That's where, in women, that's where the testosterone comes from, those adrenal glands above the kidneys.
The question is, so then what's the indication? Like, when should I feel like, oh, he is going to puberty? And like, oh, I should be concerned?
I think that, so it's hard to gauge, because boys' puberty is testicular enlargement. So unless you're examining your son's testicles, you're not going to know. I think that.
So when's his next physical?
We were there.
You were there.
I'm always there.
Right, but so I think that makes it helpful.
Yeah, I think that if the bone age is delayed to 9,
let anybody look anywhere anymore.
Well, I think that if the bone age is delayed to 9, then in theory, if he was starting into puberty, it would be on the cusp of normal early, right? There's no real great indication to like prompt somebody to push them into puberty, though. You know, being delayed in puberty is good, and if the bone age is delayed, that's good. I think you have enough evidence that everything is slow. I think that if the bone age, though, rapidly catches up, and the height is not rapidly growing in accordance with that, then that might be a reason for further evaluation, if that makes sense.
All right, last question.
So it's just a quick one.
At what age can you start checking for a bone age? You can start checking a bone age whenever, but the furthest away from completion of growth, the less reliable your height prediction is. So I tend not to do bone ages earlier than 6, but that's just my preference. The data that you're going to get is not worth it.
Thank you.
But you can do a bone age in a 1-year-old, whatever. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Klein. Thank you, Dr. Reiser.
Thank you,
guys.
Thank you all.